Alrighty, bring this camera up here. A few of you asked me about the little survey that we took last week. And let me tell you about that survey. The results were inconclusive. There you go, that's the survey. We're about dead even, split all throughout, so it's a wonder we stay united together, isn't it? I was thinking we could pick sides, we could have left and right. We could just divide up, you know, the readers, the non-readers, the mixed group, the men-only group. I'm just kidding, but Genesis chapter 32 is very fascinating. We've spent a decent amount of time in Jacob's life already, and in the lives of Abraham and Isaac. We've been in Genesis for a while. But so many things. Hebrews 11, verse 1 and 2. In the past, God spoke through the prophets at many times and in various ways. But in these last days, he's spoken to us by his Son. Many times and in various ways, God speaks. Yeah, we're going to see another example of that here. This is what you might consider a prophetic wrestling match. You know, could God get more creative in communication than a good old-fashioned wrestling match? Boy, you just can't you can't pin God down, can you? You just can't figure out how he's going to speak to people. So, starting in the 24th verse, it says Jacob was left alone. And by the way, what is the context here? I should probably pick up on that. Where we left off last week, Jacob had left somewhere, and he was beginning to go somewhere. Where did he leave? The one guy who was maybe more of a cheater than he was.
His father-in-law.
His father-in-law, that Uncle Laban. He was leaving Laban, and that was not really on good terms. May the Lord keep watch between you and I, is what they said, but that wasn't a positive watch. That was, you know, stay away from me, I'll stay away from you. Leaving that, and he was going to be reunited, but it didn't feel so good. Sorry. That's he was going to be reunited with who? His brother Esau. Last time he had heard from his brother Esau, what was his brother Esau saying? He was consoling himself with the thought of death. He was going to wait years and then finally kill his brother. That's how he left things. It's been a lot of years later, but he is panicked. He is worried, and he's going back to be reunited with his brother. That is the context of what we see here. That's when this pops up. God's given him some assurances, and this is interesting. Then Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. No ordinary man, though. When he saw that he had not prevailed against him, that's this other man, whoever it was, had not prevailed against Jacob, he touched the socket of his, that's Jacob's thigh. So the socket of Jacob's thigh was dislocated while he wrestled with him. Then he said, "Let me go, for the dawn is breaking." But he said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob, cheater." He said, "Your name shall no longer be Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with men and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him and said, "Please tell me your name." But he said, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And he blessed him there. So Jacob named the place Peniel, for he said, "I have seen God face to face, yet my life has been preserved." And that is the word, the Hebrew word for face, by the way. "My life has been preserved. Now the sun rose upon him just as he crossed over Peniel, and he was limping on his thigh. Therefore, to this day, the sons of Israel do not eat the sinew of the hip, which is on the socket of the thigh, because he touched the socket of Jacob's thigh in the sinew of the hip." Wow. You know, God could just speak truth. And he's going to. But how does God show up? Does God show up in a, you know, awe-inspiring, glorious manifestation of power, a burning bush, or some peculiar thing? No, a man. A man comes, and he's wrestling with him. How did this go down? The Bible doesn't tell us, so I guess we're left to wonder. It was, you know, Jacob just there, and then he gets jumped, you know. You get mugged, but all of a sudden that's a prophetic mugging? Is that what's going on here? They're fighting each other? And he's wrestling. It seems as though my perception of this, and you share if you have a different view here if you want, but my thought is that maybe in the beginning Jacob didn't exactly know who this was. He's kind of questioning, who are you? What are you doing here? Why is this happening? Thinking he might just be another man. But as this scene unfolds, he's starting to realize this is not just a man. Something strange is going on. When do you think would be the time when he realized this is no ordinary fella?
Probably when he touched
it. Probably when he just, I'm losing this fight. And wrenched it out of socket. Yeah. My understanding is the Hebrew word there is referring to the lightest of touches, just super light, you know. So it's obvious this is not a normal thing. Sorry. There are things that are true, but sometimes just because they're true doesn't mean they should be taught. And I'm wrestling right now in my own mind. Should I say this or not? I'm going to try to keep it vague. You guys are mature enough, okay, whatever. The term for thigh is a very broad term, okay? It encompasses a lot of times more than just the thigh. It can be translated loins, the entire area. And this is something that is just not in our culture today at all. But they took oaths specifically. You remember, was it Abraham with his servant?
Yes.
Isaac, was that it? He said, put your hand under my thigh. And probably a better translation would not be thigh, it would be in between the legs. Put your hand under here, thinking about procreation. Now, you want to talk about the seriousness of an oath. In any culture, by the way, that is a serious, serious oath right there, right? That was same word being used there. So you like not to let your mind wander too much, but I just want to point out the interesting fact that maybe we're just talking about the hip socket. It could just be that. But it is the thigh, the loins is the idea. And so God reached out and touched him, and he lived the rest of his life. And in my mind, no matter how he was touched, he would have lived the rest of his life, potentially, regardless of where God touched him, either one. So anyway, I just throw that out there just so you're aware. But the lightest of touches. And then another thing to think about, Jacob's perspective. What is Jacob thinking at this moment? He's about to go meet his brother who is planning to kill him. He's going to do it anyway. In all likelihood, he's thinking, this might be the last night I have alive on this planet. This might be it, because my brother is bigger, hairier, stronger, probably got more manpower, and he wanted to kill me last I saw him. So this is probably my last night here on Earth. What does he spend his last night doing? Well, not running. Wrestling. Holding on to someone that he finds out, who is it? No ordinary man. Who is it? Well, he actually says, I saw the face of God and my life was preserved. He figures out it's God. And I'm not letting God go. No, I will not let go of you until you bless me. And then God says, all right, well, tell me your name then. And he had to, well, cheater, deceiver, the liar. That's my name. And God says, no, not anymore. Your name will be Israel. What does Israel mean? One who struggles with God. One who struggles with God. Very fitting, right? Because that's exactly what Jacob did with mankind and with God as a person. But what about later on down the line? Jacob, when his name was changed to Israel, later on, Israel would be the name of an entire nation of people. Did that entire nation of people ever struggle with God? Boy, I'd say that's about as good a way as you can describe them. Constantly struggling with God. Constantly wrestling. Are they with him? Are they against him? Are they divided? You know, divided loyalties. They are constantly going back and forth. So that's why I'm saying this is a prophetic wrestling match. Yes, he's talking about something that's going on right here, right now, and it's a blessing that God kind of gave to him, changing his name. But that name change also pictures something that's going to take place later on in the future with his descendants. Interesting. Can we take this a step further?
Aren't we considered the new Israel?
You're right. Galatians chapter 3, verse 26 through 29, right around that part, refers to us as heirs according to this promise. If you belong to Christ, you're Abraham's seed. You're heirs according to the promise. You are a part of spiritual Israel. Well, what does that mean? Spiritual Israel. Israel is still the term of those who strive, who struggle with God. So, I don't know, maybe there's a little bit of comfort here in the sense that Israel was God's chosen people. They really blew it, and it was a sad thing, but they were. They had that special relationship, not by anything they did to deserve it. And they constantly struggled with him. We also have a special relationship with God, right? What did we do to deserve it? Absolutely nothing. We didn't really do anything to deserve it. And how are we doing with that relationship? Well, we are Israel. We are probably still struggling with God. That term is held on to in the New Testament, and I think we are growing closer and closer, but I'm a little comforted by that, because when I look at my own life, I'm like, man, it's not been smooth sailing. Like, I thought it was supposed to be like the beginning of that one roller coaster where it just launches you up straight to God. But yeah, no, it's a lot more like the down and up part where I think I'm doing great, and then I fall down a bit, and then I'm trying to get back up. It's a bit of a struggle, and I think God knew that it would be. He knew that it would be. We still struggle to be with God. And by the way, one really neat passage of scripture that you've probably read before, but if you haven't, look at it. Romans chapter 7. I love Romans chapter 7 because it is Paul talking about his personal struggle with God and trying to be faithful to him. And man, he is honest and he is hard on himself and he's just really real about how difficult it is for him in Romans chapter 7. But Romans chapter 7 comes right before Romans chapter 8. Yeah. 8, which is that wonderful, powerful passage. You know, there's therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. We win the struggle. We're going to get through it. It's not just, oh no, the struggle, that's it. No. There's good that comes because of this. But it's still a struggle. Chapter 33 is where we are. Could somebody read for me the first few verses, verses 1 through 3?
And Jacob lifted his eyes and looked, and behold, Esau was coming and 400 men with him. So he divided the children among Leah and Rachel and the two maids. He put the maids and their children in front, and Leah and her children next, and Rachel and Joseph last. But he himself passed on ahead of them and bowed down to the ground 7 times until he came near to his brother.
Proof positive that Jacob is still struggling, right? Right after God gives him this, you know, this kind of prophetic, like, you're going to be Israel. You know, I got something special for you, and I'm going to take care of you. He's still thinking, well, that's great, but what if something bad happens? Aha, we need a plan. And this is not a very nice thing at all. This is a pretty nasty thing to do. He saw Esau's coming. Quick, let's divide the children. Leah, Rachel, the two maids. Okay, maids, you're the least favorite of my partners, so you go first. Leah, sorry, weaker eyes, you go next. Rachel, my favorite wife, you know. He separated them up that way. He thought, at least he won't get them all at once. You know, I'll get to keep my favorite, maybe. Nothing good about that at all. Definitely part of his struggle with trusting God, for sure. Bows down to his brother 7 times. And I can imagine it's scary. His brother alone is a tough guy. 400 strong men with him, you know. So, verse 4 and following. Then Esau ran to meet him and embraced him, and fell on his neck and kissed him, and they wept. He lifted up his eyes and saw the women and children, and said, "Who are these with you?" So he said, "The children whom God has graciously given your servant." Then the maids came near with their children, they bowed down. Leah likewise came near with her children, and they bowed down. And afterwards Joseph came near with Rachel, and they bowed down. And he said, "What do you mean by all this company which I have met?" And he said, "To find favor in the sight of my Lord." But Esau said, "I have plenty, my brother. Let what you have be your own." Jacob said, "No, please. If now I have found favor in your sight, then take my present from my hand. For I see your face as one sees the face of God, and you have received me favorably. Please take my gift, which has been brought to you." because God has dealt graciously with me and because I have plenty. Thus he urged him and he took it. Whew. You can sense the shock and the fear that Jacob has, can't you? I mean, look at how polite that is. I mean, oh, your servant, oh, your servant, oh, my Lord, oh, bow. I'm not just going to bow, I'm going to bow seven times. Who knows, maybe he bowed a ton of times. Maybe the number seven just indicates that he wouldn't quit bowing. He is humbling himself like crazy. But God had kept his word. There's a shock, right? God did it again. He actually lived up to what he said he would. God had allowed Esau's heart to change over this time. And well,
why do you think he came with 400 men then?
Good point.
I don't know. Guess I thought he always went around with 400. And then again, I guess the other part of me thinks, boy, contingency plans? Is he wondering if his brother's going to jump him instead? Do you have a thought on this? Oh, thanks. That's an excellent question. Anyone else?
Was his... Was Esau actually looking for Jacob when he had the 400 men, or was he just like...
Well, I think...
Looking for a new habitat, too, and, oh, hey, there's my brother.
Boy, that's a good point.
I didn't know.
But I thought there was an implied warning that he was coming to meet him, but now it's all escaping me, so...
Yeah.
Good point. Somebody look into that. Yeah?
You know, there's no dialogue here that where Jacob says, I'm sorry for what I did to you. Mm-hmm. So, wouldn't you say that clearly all of this ridiculousness is his, maybe his way of apologizing to Esau? Maybe the bowing? I don't know.
I do agree with you. I think that is definitely indicative of, like, I'm at your mercy, which kind of implies I did wrong to you. I agree. I mean, even though it's not explicitly stated that he apologized, it seemed as though he was definitely humbling himself. And there's a sense in which he did do wrong, but at the same time, he wasn't the only one that did wrong, right? I mean, his father did, his mother did. There was a lot of others who helped out in this. Yeah, a lot of others. God said he was supposed to get the blessing. So, yeah, it's interesting. He's trusting God, and he's coming back to meet his brother. But he's still lining it up like, well, just in case, you know, God needs a backup plan, and we better give it to him. Kind of thing. So, he's struggling. He's struggling. Good points, guys. Good points. Then Esau said, "Let us take our journey and go, and I will go before you." But he said to him, "My Lord knows that the children are frail, that the flocks and herds, which are nursing, are a care to me. And if they are driven hard one day, all the flocks will die. Please, let my Lord pass on before his servant, and I will proceed at my leisure, according to the pace of the cattle that are before me, and according to the pace of the children, until I come near to my Lord at Seir." Esau said, "Please let me leave with you some of the people who are with me." But he said, "What need is there? Let me find favor in the sight of my Lord." So Esau returned that day on his way to Seir. Jacob journeyed to Succoth and built for himself a house and made booths for his livestock. Therefore the place is named Succoth. That's the term for booth. Now Jacob came safely to the city of Shechem, which is in the land of Canaan, when he came from Paddan Aram and camped before the city. He bought the piece of the land where he had pitched his tent from the hand of the sons of Hamor, Shechem's father, for 100 pieces of money. Then he erected there an altar and called it El Elohe Israel, or Israel. And that means God is the God of Israel. So that's what that means. Some of you were kind of snickering. Did you have a thought here? It sounded like you had a thought. When Esau said, "Let me leave some of my men with you." Maybe that wasn't a nice thing to do. Maybe that was like, a questionable thing to do.
Well, I don't know. I immediately thought, let me just make sure that you're not going to try and pull a fast one.
Boy, you ever observe people who are, you observe them and you see them interact, But even you can realize there's something clearly deeper going on. It's like the movies where the one guy shakes the other guy's hand, holds it for a while and looks at it. There's communication going on, sometimes power through the lens or whatever, but something's happening here. And you wonder, like, okay, there's a backstory to this or whatever. It does make you wonder, like what you said, he brought 400 men with him. He's offering to leave him behind. This guy is trusting God, but he's saying, oh, I'll separate the family anyway just in case, and I'll play it real, real safe with all this bowing. Is there a little bit of that? You going to kill me now? No? Maybe later? It does kind of make you wonder, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. All right, let's see if this works, because it's acting like it's not going to load. Okay, well, I'm going to try to cancel out of this and open it up again and see if that works. Oh, look, it didn't. But what I wanted to try to show you, pardon all this stuff on the screen, what I wanted to try to show you was this image that I found very interesting. And it was from a website. What was that website? I don't remember the exact name of it. But if I can flip through, I'll see if I can find it. There it is. Whew, God, it came to us. When he bought the, in the previous verse here, where it says he bought from the hand of the sons of Hamor, Shechem's father, for 100 pieces of money. It kind of makes you wonder, like, pieces of money, because this is around the time where many say, you know, there wasn't really coin currency going on here. So what is this pieces of money, and is the Bible just wrong about it? Well, no, it's not. They found this Egyptian thing, they dated to about 1380 BC, and it pictures these ringed sort of like coins. A lot of people think they have an impression sort of like a sheep on them. And this Egyptian guy is measuring them based off the weight of a cow's head. I think that's what that's supposed to be. And so the Hebrew term here, that's what a lot of people think this would be. So it is kind of like coinage. You know how God talks about weights and measures and stuff? That was a common method of currency. You know, you have the scales and then so much weight of one thing versus another. And so it stands to reason. In my mind, it almost seems like sort of like a pre-coin coin, you know, a metal-shaped ring emblem of a certain amount of weight. And it was a method of currency that apparently was used a very, very long time ago. And I just think it's neat to see when archaeology finds little things that kind of corroborate what Scripture is saying, you know. And so that's one of those things. So thanks for waiting on me to try to get that loaded up. So. Oh, Dinah! Dinah. Who's Dinah? He's his daughter. Yeah. When I was a kid, I always thought Dinah, like dinosaur. Why would you name your daughter that? It just didn't make sense to me. But, I'm sure words were different to them. This is interesting. Somebody read this for me, if you don't mind. Could you read chapter 34, the first 6 verses?
Now Dinah, the daughter of Leah, whom she had borne to Jacob, went out to visit the daughters of the land. When Shechem, the son of Hamor, the Hivite, the prince of the land, saw her, he took her and lay with her by force. He was deeply attracted to Dinah, the daughter of Jacob, and he loved the girl and spoke tenderly to her. So Shechem spoke to his father Hamor, saying, "Give me this young girl for a wife." Now Jacob heard that he had defiled Dinah, his daughter, but his sons were with his livestock in the field. So Jacob kept silent until they came in. Then Hamor, the father of Shechem, went out to Jacob to speak with him.
Interesting things going on here. So many of them. First of all, what's Dinah doing? Who's she hanging out with?
The daughters of the land.
Went out to visit the daughters of the land. Where are they? Right around the region of Canaan. I think I have a map here on this next page. Yeah. Shechem, this is the, well, later on, the land of Israel, the land of Canaan. So, Sea of Galilee up north, and then down south we have the Dead Sea. We're right smack dab in the middle. That's roughly where they think Shechem was. We are in the heart of pagan territory here, and Dinah is going out to see the daughters of the land. That scripture in the New Testament comes to mind. Bad company does what? Be careful, it corrupts good morals or good character. Yeah. She is hanging out with the wrong crowd. Now, something really bad is going to happen to her, and by the way, you know, we don't want to assign blank that doesn't belong, But the point, case in point here, is something that is important. Where you are has an effect. There are a lot of things where you have to explain to people, if you would avoid these situations, you may in fact avoid things happening that should not have ever happened. And I've heard stories that range all kinds of different things. I'm sure you've heard them too. That the guy that was just driving the car and somebody else in the back seat pulled out the gun and did something crazy or whatever, right? But what happens to him? Oh, he was the oldest, you were the one driving? Okay, we'll throw the book at this guy, you know? Well, I know it stinks, but you shouldn't have been there driving this guy around in your car. I mean, you shouldn't have. And it doesn't make it fair or right, but it shouldn't have happened. She is hanging out with the daughters of the land. There's a bad sign. With the wrong people, and then Shechem, the son of Hamor, who his dad's, he's a prince in this land, and so he's kind of got power and stuff, and the land even has his name, so, you know, powerful guy. He thinks, oh, I want her, and he takes her. And the term, I was looking into this just to make sure, because some of your Bibles might have a footnote that says, he just lay with her and defiled her. That term for defiled, my understanding is it's always used to imply a show of force. So this being, laying with her by force, rape, is probably an accurate translation of what's going on here. But then it says he was deeply attracted to Dinah, daughter of Jacob, and he loved the girl and spoke tenderly to her. Literally, the Hebrew says he spoke to her heart. Very, very interesting. I don't know, call this a study of evil for me, but just trying to look at this kind of situation, this kind of crowd. Thankfully, I didn't really grow up in this. Some of you may know others who did or whatever, but for me it's like, that just doesn't make any sense. This seems like complete nonsense. But I think there are people alive today who can understand this fully. There are people in abusive relationships, and I'm just wondering, why on earth would you stay in that? Well, I think a lot of times, the guy knows how to speak tenderly. He knows how to speak to your heart, or the girl, or whatever the situation may be. But isn't it interesting? She was violated from the get-go. It was a bad, not even relationship, bad signs, about as worst as it gets. But then later on, he's going to speak to her heart. Now, it doesn't really comment on how she feels about this, so I don't want to read too much into it. But we all know this, and let's just remember for other people's sake, just because they can say the right words and they can really say they're sorry and they didn't mean it, they would never do that again, oh, what were they thinking? They could come to tears. They could speak to your heart. It does not matter. It does not change the facts of what they did being wrong, and they are not the person that you should be with. No matter how much they've changed, you know what I mean? It's so easy to say from here when you're not in the abusive relationship, but look, how many thousand years ago, and we're still seeing a perfect example of the same kind of thing that happens. He spoke tenderly, spoke to her heart, literally. And then he spoke to his father, saying, get me this young girl for a wife. Now, to us as Americans in 21st century, that does sound pretty bad, like, get me for a wife or whatever. However, in this culture, he's probably trying to do something that is a sign of repentance for the sin that he had just committed against her. Because to marry someone was a big deal in that day. I mean, it still is today, but you were promising to take care of all her needs and make sure, and he even says, not here, later on he's gonna talk about the dowry and how I'll pay whatever you need paid, you name your price, because I wanna make this right, That's kind of what they would have thought of him doing here, I think, trying to make a step in the right direction because he needs to atone for some terrible things that he did. Still, doesn't make what he did right at all. It doesn't make this a good marriage to be happening. But what does Jacob do with this? So there are a lot of things going on in these few verses. Jacob heard first that his daughter had been defiled. We don't read about him being, irate or anything, upset about this. But what do we read about him doing? His sons were out in the field, and so what does Jacob do? He kept silent. All right, maybe I'm reading too much into this, but why would he keep silent about it?
Because he was making plans.
Mm-hmm. Thinking things? I mean, it just seems to me if something like that happened in my family, I think I would make sure my family knows that something bad has happened. You know, I don't think that's the kind of thing that I would, now granted ages or whatever, but we're talking adults of the family who know better. Why would you keep that to yourself? Maybe I'm reading too much into this, but maybe Jacob, what?
Maybe deciding that he's contemplating how he's going to react to this.
Maybe he knows his kids. Maybe he knows what they do when they hear news that is not very pleasant. I don't know, maybe, do you see it too? I just kind of am wondering, does Jacob realize that he has some kids that are a little angry, a little out of control, a little hot-tempered at times? And is there going to be anything else in their life that indicates that, I don't know, they might get jealous or angry, you know, with a brother or something? Yeah, yeah, that's going to happen too. It just, it's so interesting to me. He knows, keep silent, don't tell him, let's not even talk about this. I think Jacob realizes, Israel realizes there's a problem even in his family.
Do you think too, the guy was the prince of the land, and you've got Jacob who's never been a real, he's always kind of stepped back and
yes,
kind of like a coward.
Not taking the leadership that most people would want him to take, right? Or that probably
he's got
shouldn't
a son,
be taken.
And the sons of Leah were kind of raucous. They would have taken care of him.
Maybe it's his way into the royal family there.
Mm-hmm. There are a number of things interesting, like, wow, this is royalty. There may be something good that could happen with this, but at the same time, I can't afford a war, I don't want to afford a war, and my out-of-control sons, who knows what they're going to say. I tend to agree with what you're saying. I do think there's a big element of that going on, too. Somebody else looks like they want to say something, do they?
My words of peace. He kept his peace.
He kept his peace.
Until the sun came.
Okay. Kept it to himself. Kept silent, kept his peace. Look into that. That is interesting. All right, you guys look like you're thinking hard. I like it. Let's keep reading after we've seen where Shechem was. Verse 7 and following. Now the sons of Jacob came in from the field, and when they heard it, the men were grieved, and they were very angry, because he had done a disgraceful thing in Israel by lying with Jacob's daughter. For such a thing ought not to be done. But Hamor spoke with them, saying, "The soul of my son Shechem longs for your daughter. Please give her to him in marriage. Intermarry with us. Give your daughters to us and take our daughters for yourselves. Thus you shall live with us. The land shall be open for you. Live and trade in it. Acquire property in it." Shechem also said to her father and to her brothers, "If I find favor in your sight, then I will give whatever you say to me. Ask me ever so much bridal payment and gift, and I will give according to you, or according as you say to me, but give me the girl in marriage." Doesn't it
kind of goes back to a time when he was trying to find a wife, so maybe he's, I could parlay this into some pretty good.
Boy, Laban really pulled that one on him, and now he's in Laban's shoes. I'm glad you brought that up. He's in a real position of power here. This guy is handing him the keys of the city, isn't he? If you think about it, they're in the promised land. They're in the land where God said it was going to be theirs. And now you have a very prominent man and his family in a city named after them that everyone appears to love and respect. And there's going to be more evidence of this as we read. And he's saying, "You guys, come on in. Come be with us. As a matter of fact, we'll pay you whatever you want paid to deal with the situation. We will give you any bridal payment you want. We just want you guys to come join us, and we'll be one big happy family." And wouldn't that kind of fulfill God's promise, right? Because God promised them this land, and that God will make Jacob this great nation, just like he said about Abraham and about Isaac. I mean, you could kind of spin it that way, couldn't you? Kind of sounds good. Who wants this marriage to take place, if you think about it? Who would be the one person besides, you know, Shechem and those people? Who would be the one person, thing, that would want this marriage to take place? It would be Satan. It would. And why would Satan want a marriage like this to take place? We got to go way back, but when we go way back, why does he want this marriage to take place?
Because David comes through that line.
Yes, the promised Messiah is going to come from the offspring of the woman, way back Genesis chapter 3, verse 15. That promise is then applied to Shem. It's then applied to Abraham, to Isaac, to Jacob. The Messiah, the Savior, Jesus, the one who's going to crush Satan's head, is going to come through this family. So Satan would love to mix up and disperse this family. He wants them to intermarry with other nations because he doesn't want a clear descendant of Abraham to be alive, any man, to fulfill this promise. So Satan, I'm sure, is pulling for this. He wants this marriage to take place. It would be a wonderful thing to really thwart God's promise. But that's not at all going to happen. And man, but Jacob's sons answered Shechem and his father, Hamor, with deceit, yeah, to say the least. Because he had defiled Dinah, their sister, they said to them, "We cannot do this thing to give our sister to one who is uncircumcised, for that would be a disgrace to us. Only on this condition will we consent to you, if you will become like us, and that every male of you be circumcised. Then we will give our daughters to you, and we will take your daughters for ourselves, and we will live with you and become one people. But if you will not listen to us and to be circumcised, then we will take our daughter and go." But their words seemed reasonable to Hamor and Shechem, Hamor's son. The young man did not delay to do the thing, because he was delighted with Jacob's daughter. That seems like a sign of true love, by the way. He didn't delay. So, point that out. Now he was more respected than all the household of his father. So Hamor and his son Shechem came to the gate of their city and spoke to the men of their city, saying, "These men are friendly with us. Therefore, let them live in the land and trade in it. For behold, the land is large enough for them. Let us take their daughters in marriage and give our daughters to them. Only on this condition will the men consent to us to live with us, to become one people. Then every male among us be circumcised as they are circumcised. Will not their livestock and their property and all their animals be ours? Only let us consent to them and they will live with us." All who went out of the gate of his city listened to Hamor and to his son Shechem, and every male was circumcised, all who went out of the gate of the city. That is how you know this guy is respected. Wow. They love this guy, because you don't do that for any old guy. Just saying, you do not do that. So they had a wonderful respect for their leader, Hamor and his son Shechem, the prince there. And Jacob's sons are being very deceitful. Very, very deceitful. This is another good example of something that God is going to work through. And it makes me want to discuss something that I think most of you know, but we got to stay on top of it. What do you say to someone when they're like, you know, when you see, hey, God's working through these things, but you say, well, then he caused that? God caused that to happen? Because I didn't think God was okay with wicked lies being told and with people being killed and other people being hurt. I thought he hated that stuff. So how can you say that God works through that? Do you understand what I'm trying to say here? If it's evil, then why would God do it? And you're saying, well, God worked through it. Well, why would he want to work through evil when he could have just forced something good to happen in its place? Why couldn't he have removed the evil and forced a good thing to take place?
Because he gave us free choice.
Yeah, and why do you think God wanted us to have a free choice? Yeah, how do you have love without real choice? Same old illustration. You hold a gun to somebody's head and say, hey, do you love me? If you don't, I'm going to shoot you. They might say they love you. Do they really love you? Somehow I doubt it. How could they? You've taken away their choice. They really have none. So God cares about love and real relationships that much that he's allowed free will. And free will is necessary. It's a necessary evil, we might say. Well, if you want to reject God, and God is good, what do you have to have? You have to have something that's not good. Well, what's not good? That's bad by my definition. Anything that is not godly, not good, it's going to be evil by nature. So if God wanted us to have freedom, he has to allow us real choice, and real choice means real evil has to be able to happen. So therefore, God wanted that. But God somehow, some way, is able to work through this mess that we are in because of our sin and create something good. Does God actually use evil circumstances for good purposes? Well, yeah, of course, we know he does. Does that mean that God really wanted those evil circumstances to happen?
No,
I don't think so. Just because God used something that took place does not mean that therefore he wanted it to take place. There are some things that scripture does indicate that God raised up a certain situation and it had a greater purpose. And, you know, I understand that. But there are some things where, you know what, God, just because he knows everything, he sees everything, but he doesn't force everything. He's laid out the perfectly fair situation. He's allowed to grieve and be upset about bad things that have happened, even though he's going to use those things. I don't think he was thrilled when he saw the hearts of mankind, how they're all evil, and he knew he would have to send a flood in the world. I think he knew that that flood would be a picture of baptism in the future. I don't think he was thrilled about the flood. He wasn't happy about that. And you could go right on down the line. He rejected Saul as king. You think he was happy about that? No, I don't think he was happy about having to reject Saul as king. But he was still going to work through that and find a man after his own heart. Time and time again, that's what God specializes in. And unfortunately, we've made the mistake of pointing the blame at God and going against him instead of, as people, realizing that he's the only redeeming factor about this whole situation. He's the only one that's getting us through all the evil in this world. And yet we're trying to blame him in the first place. God is going to use a very wicked situation, a very bad lie and a very bad circumstance to bring about something that did need to happen. And we just need to remember, it doesn't mean that God wanted it to take place, but he's going to use it anyway. There's a lot of free will wrapped up in here. And by the way, even if you lay aside the free will of mankind, do you have any other free will you have to account for? You have spiritual forces and the amount of free will that they have too. Satan being a wicked angel, his forces who follow them, they apparently have free will as well. Now, what can they do with that free will? A lot of crazy things. The book of Job, first few chapters, kind of explains that. There's a lot that we don't see of free will clashing that God has to work through.
You make me think, too, back in chapter 15 when God's talking to Abraham and telling him your descendants are going to be slaves for 400 years because the iniquity of the Amalekite isn't bad enough yet. So God still intervenes sometimes and won't let bad things happen to even bad people if they don't deserve it.
Boy, that's a very good point. Yeah, he's holding off for a long time until those people deserve to be punished before they actually are punished. And we're right in around their land right now where we're talking about this. That's a good point. So God is fair, but he's still God, which means we're not always going to understand all the avenues of everything, or we would be God and that would just mess everything up. It wouldn't be right. Now, it came about on the third day when they were in pain. Why were they in pain again? What just happened?
They didn't have the script for the oxycodone.
They didn't have the wonderful prescriptions we are blessed with today. The third day when they were in pain, that two of Jacob's sons, Simeon and Levi, Dinah's brothers, makes sense because all children of Leah, Dinah's brothers, each took his sword and came upon the city unawares, which is a fun term to read, and killed every male. They killed Hamor and his son Shechem with the edge of the sword. They took Dinah from Shechem's house and went forth. Jacob's sons came upon the slain and looted the city because they had defiled their sister. They took their flocks and their herds and their donkeys and that which was in the city and that which was in the field. And they captured and looted all their wealth, and all their little ones, and their wives, even all that was in the houses. Then Jacob said to Simeon and Levi, "You have brought trouble on me by making me odious among the inhabitants of the land, among the Canaanites and Perizzites. And my men, being few in number, they will gather together against me and attack me, and I will be destroyed, I and my household. But they said, should he treat our sister as a harlot? Number of things coming together here, right? Jacob did not exercise any real form of leadership other than to try to keep the news from his kids and not really do much of anything else. So his kids find out, and they're going to fill that void. And so they react, but how do they react? It's like, you know what, when someone, you know, spills their coffee on you, do you pull out a gun and shoot them in the face? That's the kind of reaction I see here. They did something wrong. It should not have been done. But you want to talk about overreacting. Way, way, way out of proportion. They're not just killing them. They're torturing them first. Then they're killing them. Then they're stealing everything that they have. This is really, really outrageous. Imagine if your kids did that. And would your response be, I'm so, so upset with you guys. You made them all not like me. Everyone in Merritt Island's going to hate me now because you guys offed a whole family and stole their stuff. You know? Really? What kind of reaction? I mean, it says he was furious. And I believe he was. So what did he do about it? Well, Scripture doesn't tell us anything that he did about it. As far as we know, there again, Jacob's leadership, he didn't step up and punish his sons at all, as best we can tell. I mean, it doesn't even say that, as I read it, it doesn't even say that they lost the stuff that they stole from these people. They just, you know, look away, move on, smooth sailing. Man, Jacob is the kind of guy that kind of speaks to me because I am one of those people that when there's a big enough problem, I would love to close my eyes and hope, hey, maybe it's gone now. Maybe it'll go away. You know when you're a kid and there's a monster in the room? What do you do that's going to somehow protect you, you know, save you from this? You pull a thin little blanket. Some of these blankets have holes in them. Think about the logic in that. And you pull it over your head, and that's supposed to ward back this vicious, multi-headed monster. You know? But yet somehow you just, you know, maybe it'll go away or whatever. Well, unfortunately, some of us maybe don't, yeah, you can see me now. Some of us, like myself, maybe don't grow up as much as we should, and we like to think, well, I know humans have problems, but if I just look this way for a while and come back, I'm sure it'll be all better. Now, there are some things that you do need to leave patience and, you know, let time work out, you know. And perhaps the reuniting of Jacob and his brother Esau might be a good example of that. But there are some things where you need to act, and you need to act immediately. And you'd be so much better off even if you acted and didn't do the best job than by not acting at all. And by the way, not acting is an action in and of itself, right? Because you communicate one way or the other. If you ignore something bad happening and just go on, you're basically saying, it's not a big deal, it's okay by me. You're somewhat approving of it, you know. Not acting is in and of itself taking an action. But is God going to work through this? Is what Jacob says true? You know what? All the inhabitants of the Canaanites, all of them, the Perizzites, I'm going to be odious to them. They might even come together and kill me. Well, I think God's going to protect him from being killed, but is what he say about all the Canaanites hating him, is that true? Are they going to hate him because his sons wouldn't slaughter the whole town? I don't know about you, but that'd be enough for me to kind of strongly dislike somebody. You know what I mean? If he didn't stop his kids and he just went and killed everyone? Yeah. They are going to hate him. Are the Canaanites hating Jacob and his family, the future of the Israelites, is that a good thing? Yeah. Absolutely, it's a good thing. Right? Because we cannot have these people uniting together. The promise is through Abraham, through Isaac, through Jacob, through his family. They are going to occupy this land, yes, but the crusher, Jesus, the one who's going to destroy the work of the devil, the Son of Man, he's coming through this line, and we cannot have them mingling with others. That's what Satan wants to have happen. So through this awful circumstance, God has done something very smart. He has made it to where they don't want to touch. They hate him so much, nobody's going to try to give their daughter in marriage to this family. It's not going to be a natural thing. But he doesn't stop there. It's not just that they will not want to intermarry with Jacob and his family, but there's something else that God provides. I'm going to see if it's in the text or not. later on, and I don't remember exactly where I read it, it's one of those things that, man, God put what is referred to as the fear of Jacob on the people. He put a fear on them that they were terrified of this guy. You know, the top thug in the playground or whatever, they were scared of him. So what did he accomplish there? Well, number one, they're not going to intermarry with him. Number two, they're not going to kill him either. He's got a perfect separation in place to bring about the ultimate plan, which is what? Christ coming into the world to deliver us and to destroy the work of the devil. Chapter 35. Any questions from chapter 34 before we get started on this 35th chapter?
That one word, odious.
Odious?
Yeah.
Yeah. What is your, does your version say something different, or does it have the same word?
No, I mean, look. Where was that?
Oh, let's see. Where was that?
Look at up there.
Made me odious to the...
Oh, 30.
Verse 30? 30. Odious. Yeah. I felt like that was one of the words I had in school, right? Like, totally disgusted by... Is that a good definition of the word odious?
Detestable.
Obnoxious. Detestable.
Yep, that's what mine says. Stink.
Stink? Oh, I like that. You made me stink to them. Yeah. Well, that's true. It had bad odor and all the dead around there, too. Yeah. You know, man, we killed them all, and now they think I stink. Yeah. That's understatement of the day. Understatement of the day. Any other thoughts for what's going on here? All right, let's read a little bit before we stop. Then God said to Jacob, "Arise, go to Bethel and live there. Make an altar there to God who appeared to you when you fled from your brother Esau." So Jacob said to his household and to all who were with him, "Put away the foreign gods which are among you." Where did those come from? "And purify yourselves and change your garments. And let us arise and go to Bethel, and I will make an altar there to God, who answered me in the day of my distress, and has been with me wherever I have gone." So they gave to Jacob all the foreign gods which they had, and the rings which were in their ears. And Jacob hid them under the oak which is near Shechem. As they journeyed, there was a great terror upon the cities which were around them. And they did not pursue the sons of Jacob. I knew it was in there. Terror of Jacob. So Jacob came to Luz, that is Bethel. Remember, Luz used to mean separation, but now Bethel, the name means house of God, which is in the land of Canaan, and all the people who were with him. He built an altar there, and he called the place El Bethel, because there God had revealed himself to him when he fled from his brother. Now, Deborah, Rebekah's nurse, died, and she was buried below Bethel under the oak. It was named Alon Bakuth, which means the oak of weeping. Where'd these idols come from? Seems kind of random.
The daughters of the city.
Perhaps the daughters of the city. They've been dwelling in Canaanite territory for a while.
Well, his wife took one.
Yeah,
on
Rachel.
Her way out. Yeah, remember, she was holding on to the household idols. Rachel was, and she kept them for... So some people think that's what we're talking about here. Perhaps also, it could just be some of the... I mean, remember, he accumulated women, servants, and other people. Simeon and Levi just did, and there were others. Maybe some of them still had their idols with them. You know, some good luck charms, those things were, if they had them with them. We should have got rid of them anyway. It didn't work. But you know what I mean? Maybe that's where this stuff came from. Regardless, they said, put that away. But that wasn't enough. What else do they say you need to do? Take out the jewelry. And what else? Change your clothes. What's the reasoning behind that? Remember in Bible days, people get all upset. They're like, tear their clothes up. What is it? What is their deal? Why would they tear their clothes? They're really, really angry, but what's the significance of ripping up a garment that you're wearing?
It's no good anymore.
It's no good anymore, so you're not going to be wearing it anymore. And the idea is, I'm so upset about this day, I'm so frustrated about what's going on, I don't even want to see the clothes I was wearing. I want nothing to do with it. I want to leave it behind. Well, maybe that's what's going on here. You know what? Change your clothes. Get rid of your idols. Get rid of all this. We need to leave all this stuff behind us because we are going to straighten up and make a change. And if that's the reason why, and I think it probably is, this is something good to be said for Jacob. He realizes, I've gotten slack, and I've allowed things to go on that shouldn't have gone on, and finally he's taking a little bit of leadership. a little bit to say, hey, we're going to leave this stuff behind and we're going to travel back. And this parenthetical note here, this, you know, Deborah, Rebecca's nurse, died and she was buried below the tree. I felt like I had a note about that. It's interesting. It speaks to some of the lifespans they have here. And I'm going to skip ahead and show you something because I find it interesting. We'll pick it up again next week. So excuse me while I fast forward a little bit to this chart right here. Key events. What I want you to just look at right now is the lives. Isaac, Jacob, and then later on we have his son, one of his sons, Joseph. Look at the overlap. I'm glad you pointed this out to me earlier. It made me go looking for it. Look at how long Isaac lived compared to Jacob, compared to Joseph. But all three of them were alive together for quite a while. And reading the Bible, sometimes you don't get that impression, but when you start pulling together dates and stuff, it's very, very interesting. Isaac would have been alive for a huge portion of Jacob's life. Huge portion of that. And even for a lot of Joseph's life. And then it gets even more fun when you start backing off and comparing it to other places. This is a timeline of Genesis that someone's put together, and I realize it's harder to see because we're all here, but look at that. See how far Adam lives, you know, all the way up into the days of Enoch and Methuselah. Like, they're alive at the same time if you just go with the straight numbers that were given. Methuselah dies, but in the flood, well, he was already the oldest, but maybe he would have gotten older, you know, you just don't know. But then you go right on down the line. There is a lot of overlap between these lives that you may not remember being there. It may not be apparent. Because God's word is focusing in on some people in some very specific ways. But don't forget, there's other things going on here too. So, I don't know, I just found that kind
of interesting. So Noah could have been alive when Abraham was called?
Wow. So we have Noah here. Wait, Abraham. The fourth one up, 1, 2, 3, 4. Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. Very, very interesting. Guess so, if this chart is accurate. Interesting. Any other questions or comments? Let's pray. God, thank you for stretching our minds and for giving us thoughts to share with each other that are going to help us to grow. God, please help us to be the leaders that you want us to be. And God, I recognize, as we were already talking about, choosing not to make a decision is still making a decision. And sometimes you've put us in places where that's what we need to do. We need to sit back and let somebody else take the lead because that's their job. But God, there are other times where you've clearly specified it's our job. And we need to be brave and to do it, and we need to not shrink back. So please give us the wisdom and the, not just the endurance, but the boldness to be the leaders that we are supposed to be in this world and to not back down because we know you're by our side and we're doing something that you want, and that's really all that matters. So give us the courage to do that and help us grow closer to you this week. We pray this in Jesus' name.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
It was jelly.